And just in case you think they might, just put them side by side and check it out. Nothing embarrassing there. In those times that you feel like maybe you're missing something, that there could be something different or better. Nothing compares to the promise of that. All right, that being said, how are you doing this morning?
Okay.
Good, open your Bibles to Ephesians. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, that we have such great and wonderful, precious promises from you, Lord Jesus. Namely, and most importantly, that you will always love us. You will never forsake us. But we belong to you, Lord Jesus. Because you died on that cross, Calvary, and paid the price for our sins. And those who believe in you might have everlasting life. Thank you, Jesus. In the name of prayer. Amen. All right. Last week, we had our introduction to this letter to the church at Ephesus. Remembering that Ephesus was that place where it seemed to be one of Paul's favorites. He spent the most time there. The Lord opened the door to them because there were many adversaries there. Sort of the end of his ministry there, after about 3 years of teaching and preaching and house to house and all that stuff, with a big ruckus in town, there were so many people getting saved and coming to accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior, getting saved, burning their books for magic and all that stuff, putting away all their idols and everything, that it affected the economy in Ephesus. Because a lot of their economy was built off of the pagan idol worship and the production of these little pagan idol things. Now imagine having such an impact in a major commercial city in this country, that so many people came to Christ that it affected the economy. It's quite an impact, isn't it? So much so that it caused a riot. Those that were, their livelihood, their money was being affected, they came against them, and everybody got into a big tumult and started a riot in the Colosseum there. And there were even people there that were going and getting to be part of the riot, and they had no idea why they were having a riot. Just might as well go ahead and do it, because everybody else is, right? We're having a riot. What side are you on? There's a side. Who knows? Anyhow, the Lord took care of that and everything. Things changed in Ephesus. And as Paul left there and traveled a few other places on his journey back towards Jerusalem, he gathered those elders there and told them to shepherd the flock from his flock. Have that heart for them. They were all sad because they said that he told them that they would never see his face again. But Paul, while in Roman custody, in Roman prison, writes this letter. And again, as with the other prison epistles, it's amazing that someone in those conditions could write something that was so encouraging. And we know that it's the Holy Spirit, that it's the Lord inspiring, using Paul as that pen to do so. So, as we get into this, we saw that Paul the Apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, it's always good to be what you're being according to the will of God, isn't it? Instead of the will of somebody else. Maybe even your own. To the saints who are in Ephesus, it lets us know who this letter is directed to. It's not to those out there in the world, those that aren't saved. It's to the saints. It's to us. The letter to us to pay attention to. And of course, the grace and peace that come from that the source is our God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul says in verse 3, it says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise and the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. Now, as we go through here, and point by point, we can take each one and spend a lot of time just taking them all apart and everything. We have to look at these and see the things that the Lord has done. Somebody told me today that they listened to the Bible on audio, and it took like 15 minutes to do the book of Exodus. We're going to take longer than that. All of these things, it says that we are blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. And again, to point out that it says that he has blessed us. And that means that he already did it. That those blessings, those spiritual blessings in heavenly places, are ours. Not something that we will get later on. He's already done it. We're already blessed with those spiritual blessings. All that spiritual stuff, that spiritual inheritance. We're already citizens of the kingdom of God. We were talking about having eternal life. You know, and somebody said, you're just a heartbeat away from eternity. No, you're not. If you're saved, you're already there. You're already there. That happened when you were saved, when you were born again. All of these things became ours. That song, I am who you say I am. This is the position that we have in Christ, and as we talked about, the foundation of our lives as Christians. And yet so often many believers live their lives as if these things were afar off. This is our position in Christ, but this is our practice in life. Well, we're supposed to practice our life according to the position that we have in Christ. And to view things from this perspective. He has blessed us, Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. He chose us. We look at this and we say, Jesus chose us. Wait a minute, wasn't there that time when I chose him? When I asked him to be my Lord and Savior? Are we saved because he chose us? Or were you saved because you chose him? The short answer to that is yes. Yes. Yes, he chose us. Think about that. The Lord Jesus Christ chose to save you and me. You might think about the Lord chose to save me. Well, okay. But you? Yeah. He chose us. It was his choice to come to that cross and die for our sins. To come and to save us and give us everlasting life. It was his choice, it says there. He chose in him before the foundations of the world that we should be holy. Before the foundations of the world. That goes back to in the beginning. So before in the beginning, the Lord chose us. We go, now wait a minute. Kind of gets the running around in our heads and we get a little confused about that. The problem is that oftentimes we think of time as being eternal. And when did God start? When we look at it as it is, that time is something that God created. And in the beginning, he said, let all the stuff be. It was time, space, and matter in the different configurations that he put it together in. So time is not something that contains God, but something that God created and is contained by him. You got it? That's crystal clear, isn't it? But when you see that from that perspective, then it's not hard for us to understand how God could choose us before the foundations of the world were laid. Because he knew that time would come that we would be one of those that whosoever that said yes to the offer of salvation through Jesus Christ. made that plan before everything was created. So before time, before the foundations of the world, the Lord chose us. Good to be chosen, isn't it? How many of you were those kids that when it came time for picking teams, everybody said, I want him, I want her. Chose you first. How many of you were the kid that stood over there and everything, and the two captains of the team had to have a fight over who had the team? Yeah, that was me. I had athletic prowess, or whatever you call it. I had none of that. Still don't. And I was like, you got him, boy, you take him. Like, you know what, I'll go somewhere else. Forget about it. But our Lord Jesus Christ chose us, knowing everything about you. Even the stuff you haven't done yet. Everything. Every thought and tip of your heart. All the bonehead things that you have done. What? Yep. But we know this, that the Lord is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to salvation. He wants everyone. We're chosen in Christ. He chose us in Him before the foundations of the world. If He could see all of your life, every bit of it, know it, every detail, and still chose us before the foundations of the world were ever laid, then we know that our place in Christ is secure today and tomorrow. It's not like you get this Tuesday and everything and really mess up. You know what? I'm not going to put you back. A choice was made before the foundations were ever laid. For the foundations of the world, that you should be holy and without blame before Him in love. That you should be holy. How many of you are holy? Two or three? The rest of you, because you're not saved or anything? How many of you are holy? In Christ we all are, aren't we? What does holy mean? That you're perfect. No. Holy means that you're set apart in Christ. And we're chosen and set apart for Him. He said, I will take you and set you apart over here for me. So I remember a commercial. I don't remember exactly what it was. It seemed like there was some candy and everything. And the little kids divvying out the candy to share with everybody else. One for you, two for me, one for you.
Yeah.
I says, Lord, this is mine. I'm taking you for myself. We're set apart holy in Christ Jesus. We're His. Because He loves us. Set apart and without blame. Wait a minute. Without blame, yeah, you know what? I've made some dumb choices and all this stuff. Without blame, because Christ took care of that. There is now therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. And that's one of those heavenly spiritual blessings that we have now. Not hoping to achieve or to get there. We are holy. We are without blame in Christ Jesus. Without spot or blemish. Sometimes we wish we could see ourselves that way. We are who He said He is, right? Remember the song? Holy, without blame, set apart before Him in love. Why? Because He loves us. Verse 5. Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will. We talk about predestination, and there's a whole thing where you can get into a big long discussion and arguing, and people, Christians, believers have been arguing about predestination versus free will forever. It comes back to the first question we asked. Are we saved because He chose us or because we chose Him? Yes. Predestination is based on God's knowledge of all things, all time, everything. Predestination means He chose us, but it does not mean that He chose others not to be saved. What does the Bible tell us? He desires all to be saved and come He didn't choose some to be saved. He didn't look around the room in here and say, well, you. Eh, I don't know about you guys over there. I don't want you. It wasn't that thing, that game thing on the playground where you know, it wasn't that thing. Predestined. Look at Romans chapter 8. It says, and we know, verse 28, that's quite helpful. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. It says, and we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, to those who are called according to his purposes. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn born among many brethren. Moreover, who he predestined, these he also called. Who he called, these he also justified. And who he justified, these he also glorified. Who are those these that he's talking about? Us. Those that he's chosen. We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, for those who are called according to his purposes. That verse to really apply to things in your life, you have to ask the first question, do you love God? Are you called according to his purposes? Are you walking in that? Then trust that all things will work together for that good. It says, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed into the image of Christ. Everybody says, God's got a plan, doesn't he? That's true. He did. That plan was made before the foundations of the earth. You say, well, God, can you revise that a little bit? Because I don't really like where I'm at right now. Are you following his will or yours? That might be a good question to start with that one. Those who we foreknew. Again, that comes back to he foreknew us. When you came to Christ, when you gave your life to Jesus Christ, you may have surprised a lot of people. You know, I certainly did. But I got saved. Oh, what did you get saved for? What do you mean? I gave my life to Christ Jesus. I'm a Christian. Sure you are. No, really. Remember a friend of mine that I worked with laughing one time when I first got saved and started going to church. Where you been? Where you been? I went to church. You did? Where you been? No, I went to church, man. You may have surprised a lot of people with that. Not the Lord. You didn't come to Christ and say, hey, Lord, I'd like to take you up on that free gift of salvation. You went, really? Wow, I didn't see that coming. He foreknew. He knew all that stuff. Foreknows what's coming too. Foreknows, he knows what's coming too. What you do, you're not going to surprise them. But he's got a plan to work things out in your life for good if you love him. If you are called to his purpose, if you're walking. Didn't surprise him, didn't take him by surprise. He's not going to, there's nothing you can do or have done. And I like when you confess your sins. Oh, and by the way, Lord, I did this. He goes, oh, really? He knows. He foreknew and predestined, made a plan. What? To be conformed to the image of Christ. Have you ever been conformed? Look around the room, I know most of you people here. You guys are somewhat rebellious in certain things, aren't you? You don't mind going along, but you don't really like the whole idea of being conformed, do you? And yet the Lord does that. He conforms you together. It's like being a rebel. You know, you want to be rebellious, so what do? You go find a bunch of other people to be rebellious with. So now you're conformed to that. Yeah, I told some of you heard this before, there's a motorcycle club out there called the Loners. It doesn't make any sense. I was talking to a guy that was a loner one time, him and his buddies. I looked at this guy and I said, "Loners, huh?" He goes, "Yep, that's right." I said, "So what do? Get together and go for a ride by yourselves?" He didn't think it was quite as amusing as I did. But are you happy and willing to be conformed to the image of Christ as the Lord's plan is for you? We don't know the details of that plan and everything, day-to-day details of it. He can reveal those to us as we go. But we know that the general plan, the idea that what he's doing, working to the good of us who love him, is to conform us, make us into, mold us into the image of Christ, so that others might see him, not us, come to him. And being molded into that image of Christ. Back over in Ephesians, verse 5. Predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will. Predestined us to be conformed to that image, to be adopted as sons. You know what adoption is, don't we? We look first at John chapter 1, verse 12. Talking about Jesus coming in the flesh and all that. It says, "But as many as received him, Jesus, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. We're born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." Again, according to his will. He gave us the privilege to become children, to be adopted into that family. By that spirit of adoption, we cry out, "Abba, Father." Don't we? It speaks to that question that I'm sure you have as well as I heard people say. Usually it's an unbeliever. Aren't we all God's children? If we were, then this part would not need to be in there. That wouldn't have had to happen. He wouldn't have had to give us the right to become children, to adopt us. How many of you adopted your own flesh and blood children? No? You can adopt another child, can't you? You can adopt someone else. But if they're yours, they're yours. He adopted us into that family because we were not his children. His creatures, yes. Are we all God's creatures? Yep. So are skunks. You can adopt one of them if you want to. He didn't. He gave us that right, that privilege to be adopted as his children. And the interesting thing about this in this culture, the Hebrew deal there with the Jews, you could disown your own child if you wanted to. But if you adopted one, you could not ever disown them again. Isn't that great? Can't disown me. You chose me. I'm yours. You love me. We were adopted. Verse 6. Adopted to be sons by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will. According to his good pleasure. Not comfort. Wait, verse 6. According to his good pleasure of his will. Why? He wanted to. He wanted to. It gave him pleasure. It was his will. We think about Jesus coming and dying on the cross and all that. The brutal shameful death that he died on that cross because of our sin. Always important for us to remember who killed Jesus. We did, our sin. He died for our sin and us. But he did it because he wanted to. Remember, Pilate said, "Don't you understand that I have the power of life and death? I can let you off the hook here." This he said to Jesus after he was beaten. He said, "I can let you go, man." Jesus said, "You have no power except what my Father has given you." Jesus came in there on the cross as he was hanging there. Said, "Father, into your hands I commit my soul." He gave it up. Jesus, before he went to Jerusalem, he told the disciples, "I go there to be crucified. No one's taking my life from me, but I give it freely." Why? Every good pleasure of his will. Because he loved us so much, he saw that separation of sin and paid the price so that we could be restored and adopted us back into his family because he wanted to. I have a thought about loving him. Why? Because he first loved us. Verse 6, "To the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he has made us accepted in the beloved." Why? To the praise and the glory of his grace. What better picture of God's grace? That he foreknew us, all of us, everything about us, beginning to end, our sinfulness, and still yet chose to come and give himself on that cross that we might have life in him. That we might be able to be adopted into the family so he can say that we are his. He chose that. Why? For his good pleasure, according to his will. Because of his love for us. What praise of the glory of his grace. Talk about God's grace. Can we praise the glory of that grace? His grace glorified in our life? Do we remember who we are, who we were? That while we were yet sinners, while we were enemies, that he chose to die on the cross for us. Give us that life. What glory, what praise, the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. We like to be accepted, don't we? Like when we're accepted, when we're part of the group, when we're in with the clique, when we get chosen for the game. We like to be accepted. Apart from Jesus Christ and what he did on that cross, we're not accepted. We're not part of God's family. We're not his children. But he wants us to be. He wants us to be. Those who have not accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, are not his. They're his creatures, not his children. He chose to die on the cross for our sins to pay that price that we might have life again. That we might be his. Because he loved us. What a great picture, isn't it? You take that and you come back to John 3:16. For God so loved the world. All of us. That he gave his only begotten Son. Why? Because he loved us. That whoever believes in him can have everlasting life. That will give him that we accept him with no one again. He said, "Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Die on the cross for my sin. Be Lord of my life. drop me back into the family. For his. Because that's what he wants. And it's that offer that he's giving us. The Lord wants to love us. That's his goal. Do you let him? Sometimes we push back. Sometimes we say no. Sometimes we want to do it our way. Sometimes we do our own thing. Sometimes we're rebellious. And sometimes we find other rebels to be with. If the Lord just wants to love us, will we let him? He's our Father. He did this because he wanted to. Because he loves us. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for your great love. And you gave yourself for us. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us. Amen.